The subcommittee will come to order. The subcommittee is meeting today to review the Coast Guard's major acquisition programs. At the subcommittee, as this subcommittee has continually highlighted, the Coast Guard currently operates tens and in some cases hundreds of thousands of hours short of its operational targets. This means assets are not there for the service to secure our ports, protect our environment, and ensure the safety of our waterways. Last month, the subcommittee held a hearing on Coast Guard missions and heard from the service's vice admiral in charge of operations, who attributed much of the failure to meet mission performance goals to not having a sufficient number of modern assets. The only way to reverse the decline in the Coast Guard's mission performance is to make the necessary investments to acquire new and improved assets. Unfortunately, based on the FY 2016 budget requests, as well as the FY 2016 through 2020 SIP, it appears the President refuses to make those investments. The President's budget cuts funding needed to acquire critically needed replacement assets by 17%. The budget also fails to guarantee the funding needed to begin detailed design for the offshore patrol cutter. Failure to move into the detailed design on the OPC by the end of 2016 could result in significantly higher costs and substantial acquisition delays. Moving this and other acquisitions further to the right will only further degrade Coast Guard mission performance. Unfortunately, the situation does not improve any time in the near future. According to the Coast Guard's capital investment plan over the next 5 years, annual funding for acquisitions never exceeds $1.2 billion. That is approximately $1 billion less than the GAO and the former Commandant of the Coast Guard have testified is needed on an annual basis to keep the current acquisition program on schedule and on budget. The SIP is nothing more than a roadmap to additional acquisition delays, increased costs for taxpayers, and ongoing mission performance failures. I have said this for some time now. If the President's going to send us budgets that fail to pay for the assets needed to meet the Coast Guard mission requirements, then it's time for him and the Coast Guard to review their mission requirements. That's why in the last bill that we passed, the Howard Coble Coast Guard Maritime Transportation Act of last year, that required the Coast Guard to submit a revised mission needs statement to this committee. The mission needs statement is the underlying justification for the service's acquisition program. It lays out mission requirements and helps identify gaps and capabilities. So if you don't have the assets, you're not going to get the assets unless you change the mission to match the assets. The Coast Guard has assured the subcommittee that that we will receive the revised mission needs statement in July. At that time, I intend to hold a hearing to review it and determine whether the administration intends to continue the charade of expanding Coast Guard mission requirements without providing the Coast Guard the assets it needs to meet those requirements. In the interim, I look forward to today's update on the status of the Coast Guard's current acquisition programs and the challenges the service is facing. We got our gavel. Now we're a real subcommittee. It's good. And the challenges that the service is facing in fielding these new assets. I thank the witnesses for appearing today and look forward to their testimony. With that, I yield to Ranking Member Garamundi.
Chairman, thank you very much, and to your staff, thank you for meeting our need for caffeine and coffee. Appreciate that. I appreciate the opportunity to once again assess the Coast Guard's ongoing efforts to recapitalize its surface, air, and communications assets. And nothing should be more important to this subcommittee than our responsibility to ensure that our nation's multi-mission military maritime law enforcement authority has the tools it needs to meet the many challenges it faces day in and day out off our shores and around the world. The Coast Guard's Capital Investment Program, or CIP, is essentially a roadmap. The Coast Guard provides this plan to Congress to help guide our decisions on what and how much we should invest annually to fulfill the largest recapitalization program in the service's illustrious history. Fortunately, the Coast Guard has been able to make some really important progress in this effort. For example, it has begun on the eighth and last national security cutter. Once built, this final hull will complete the transition from the legacy fleet of high endurance cutters to a new modern cutter fleet that is fewer in number but far more technologically capable than its predecessors. However, there are concerns. Regrettably, the offshore patrol cutter, the largest and most expensive acquisition in the entire recapitalization effort, still remains a concept on the Naval Architect's drawing board and is far, far away from entering production. Even some of the new assets that have been provided to the Coast Guard, such as the 14 C-27Js aircraft that were authorized to be transferred from the Air Force to the Coast Guard, and by the way, good work in making that happen. Thank you. The tempo to bring these new assets online is far too slow, raising the potential for future operational gaps in the Coast Guard's fleet of fixed-wing patrol craft. Then there are other unmet needs. We can go on with a lengthy list, and I will, of planned or unplanned needs. Recapitalization of the Coast Guard's, you'll like this, Mr. Chairman, polar icebreaker. I think we've heard that discussed here many times. Well, more than $1 billion possibly being spent on that. How are we going to get the money for that? Additionally, there's substantial backlog of unmet shoreside infrastructure needs that was last estimated at over $1.4 billion. And while we should be pleased that the Coast Guard was able to complete the Mission Effectiveness Program, MEP, to extend the service lives of its legacy fleet of medium endurance cutter, the delays in the production of the new OPCs will almost certainly require yet another round of mission effectiveness projects. And that's a challenge for Congress. Mr. Chairman, you were speaking about the President's budget, and indeed it is too little. However, it is reflective of this thing called the Budget Control Act, otherwise known as sequestration, which is our problem, that we need to break through that and find a much more rational way of funding the necessary governmental programs. Well, moving back to the Coast Guard, anything less than a full-on effort by the Coast Guard to meet its capital requirements will leave the Coast Guard far short of always ready, sempre provatus. But a Coast Guard that is hollow, a vestige of the proud maritime institution that has served this nation for very long, is not what we want. And we share the responsibility of making sure the Coast Guard has what it needs to be always ready. I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Thank the gentleman from California. Our first witness today is Rear Admiral Bruce D. Baffert, the Coast Guard's Assistant Commandant for Acquisition and Chief Acquisition Officer. Admiral, you're recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Chairman Hunter, Ranking Member Garamendi, members of the subcommittee, good morning. Thank you for the opportunity to speak on Coast Guard recapitalization. On behalf of the Commandant, as well as the men and women of the Coast Guard, thank you for your oversight and continued support of our service. My complete statement's been provided, and I ask that be entered into the record. The Coast Guard's Acquisition Directorate is tasked with managing an annual portfolio in excess of $1 billion to deliver the goods and services to Coast Guardsmen need to perform their missions in the field. To these ends, we continue to invest in our acquisition enterprise, attracting talented professionals to the Coast Guard, maturing military and civilian career paths, and providing training and certification opportunities to grow and retain our highly capable acquisition workforce. We formalized and documented our processes and procedures, and we're applying lessons learned. I'd also like to acknowledge the very effective working relationship we enjoy with the Government Accountability Office. Over the last 14 years, Ms. Mackin has applied her leadership through numerous audits, helping the Coast Guard realize our vision as a model acquisition enterprise. I'd also like to recognize the Navy League for their strong ongoing support of the Coast Guard, both at the national and the local chapter levels. In short, we've been busy. Over just the past few months, we completed the program record for the response boat medium with delivery of the 174th boat. We completed acceptance trials on the 5th National Security Cutter and awarded a contract for the production of the 8th and final cutter in the NSC program of record. We issued a request for proposals with full and open competition for the remaining 26 fast response cutters and took delivery of the 7th and 8th C-130J aircraft. The Commandant continues to make recapitalization one of his highest priorities, and recognizing the budget environment, we're maximizing every dollar. To this end, we're emphasizing competition and affordability across the portfolio by employing DOD's Better Buying Power Initiative, particularly focusing on competition, early industry engagement, fixed price contracts, and affordability as a requirement. As an example, our highest priority acquisition program, the Offshore Patrol Cutter, has been structured to affordably meet the Coast Guard's most pressing offshore mission requirements through the use of commercial standards, fixed price contracts, and state-of-the-market technologies. We're employing an acquisition strategy that maximizes competition and promotes the domestic shipbuilding industrial base by removing the traditional barriers to enter the military shipbuilding market. We will select a single contractor in fiscal year 2016 to complete the detailed design and ultimately construct the vessel. On the aviation side, the Coast Guard is regenerating 14 C-27J medium-lift aircraft, providing much-needed maritime patrol capability. This subcommittee played a crucial role in facilitating the transfer from the Air Force to the Coast Guard, injecting additional capabilities year ahead of schedule and minimizing cost to taxpayers. I know the subcommittee is particularly interested in our efforts to increase icebreaking capability. As we continue to develop requirements for a new heavy icebreaker, we're also beginning the preservation and evaluation process on Polar Sea. There is no question that the cost of acquiring a new icebreaker and potentially reactivating Polar Sea poses a particular challenge in this current budget environment. In closing, I'm extremely proud to lead the dedicated professionals working tirelessly to ensure Coast Guard has the capabilities to safely and affordably carry out our 11 statutory missions. Successful programs such as the NSC, FRC, HC-144, C-130J, RBM, and Rescue 21 are providing mission capability now and will be for decades to come. I'm absolutely certain the OPC will be equally successful in meeting all of our performance and affordability requirements. But none of these successes happen without this subcommittee's foresight and commitment. Thank you for the opportunity to testify today. I thank you for your steadfast support of our Coast Guard. I look forward to answering your questions.
Thank you, Admiral. Our next witness today is Ms. Mackin, the GAO's Director of Acquisition and Sourcing Management. You're recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good morning, Ranking Member Garamendi, members of the subcommittee. Thank you for having me here today to discuss Coast Guard acquisitions. As we've noted in our recent reports, the Coast Guard has made strides in its acquisition management capabilities. As the Admiral mentioned, competition has been injected into recent procurements, and new assets are being delivered to the operators. Key test events are also taking place. I'll briefly touch on three issues this morning. First, the C-27J aircraft transfer and overall status of fixed-wing flight hours. Second, observations on the major cutter fleet. And third, I'll discuss what we view as the most pressing concern facing the Coast Guard, which is the affordability of its acquisition portfolio. As you know, the Coast Guard is receiving 14 C-27Js from the Air Force at no cost. Once operational, these aircraft will contribute to Coast Guard missions, but it will take time and money to transfer them from storage, assess their condition, establish a spare parts pipeline, and modify them to meet Coast Guard missions. The full fleet of 14 operational aircraft is anticipated in 2022, and about $600 million will be needed to operationalize the fleet. A broader observation regarding the fixed-wing fleet is that under the Coast Guard's current plan, even with the C-27Js, the Coast Guard will fall almost 20% short of its annual flight hour goal, which is currently 52,400 hours. The Coast Guard is in the process, as was mentioned, of revisiting its 2005 mission needs statement and conducting a fleet mix analysis that may result in a different flight hour goal or different mix of aircraft. However, the fleet mix analysis will not be complete until 2019. Regarding surface assets, all eight national security cutters are on contract or delivered, and the ship recently completed operational testing. A general observation there is that the NSC was determined operationally effective and suitable, but with several major deficiencies, and we're currently doing a more detailed review of the test at the request of the subcommittee. To touch on other cutters, the Coast Guard is preparing to recompete the remaining 26 fast response cutters, and it's also pursuing a competitive acquisition strategy for the offshore patrol cutter. The Coast Guard plans to award a contract for design of the first tranche of these ships next year. However, the Coast Guard faces a significant gap between the projected delivery dates of the OPCs and the end of service life for the legacy medium endurance cutters these ships are replacing. The Coast Guard is studying how to make the legacy cutters viable for a longer period to close this gap, but no decision has been made. Finally, the Coast Guard faces affordability challenges that are not reflected in the five-year capital investment plan. The primary driver, of course, is the OPC, expected to cost $12 billion, which will take up over two-thirds of the Coast Guard's acquisition funding while it's being built. Our concern is that the Coast Guard has not set forth a long-term acquisition plan for its surface and aviation assets, such as the 20-year plan we recommended last year and which this subcommittee also calls for in its Coast Guard Authorization Act. Such a plan should include necessary trade-offs that reflect budget realities. We've recommended since 2010 that the Coast Guard conduct this type of assessment. We believe this approach would help ensure that all stakeholders, including Congress, understand the constraints the Coast Guard is facing long-term and what it can realistically acquire at expected funding levels. Thank you. This concludes my statement, and I'll be happy to answer questions at the appropriate time.
Thank you, Ms. Mackin. Our final witness today is Mr. James Offutt, National President of the Navy League of the United States. Mr. Offutt, you're recognized.
Garamundi, members of the committee, thank you for the opportunity to appear before you on such an important topic. I'd like to submit my full testimony for record. I offer an abbreviated version now and look forward to your questions. The U.S. Coast Guard is a very unique service with military and civil responsibilities and humanitarian missions. The Coast Guard has seen its area of responsibility grow to 11 statutory missions, but its budget growth has not kept pace with this increase, failing to match mission demand or be adjusted for inflation. Despite their incredible record of achievement, the Coast Guard faces many familiar but daunting challenges. Increased Arctic activity, increased maritime transportation goods, and increased human and drug trafficking all add to demands on the Coast Guard. The service will not properly be equipped to meet these challenges unless we make serious investments now. Coast Guard has been clear that it needs an acquisition budget of $2.5 billion per year to fill its mission. Unfortunately, the administration continually requests an acquisition budget that hovers at or below $1 billion, with Congress providing the extra funding. The administration's low budget requests for acquisition, construction, and improvements, or ACNI, represent the bare minimum funding for the Coast Guard to accomplish its missions. The Navy League knows with disappointment that the requested funding level for fiscal year 2016 is totally unsatisfactory. Given the fiscal climate, the Navy League recommends a budget of at least $1.5 billion per year, as this committee has authorized, to help the Coast Guard achieve its recapitalization goals. The highest ACNI priority for the Coast Guard is to lay the groundwork for construction of the offshore patrol cutter, which will replace cutters built in the 60s and 80s. The importance of the OPC cannot be overstated. It will function as a service operational workhorse to carry out the Coast Guard's primary missions over the next 40 years. Given the magnitude of the impending capability gap caused by the decommissioning of older cutters, the Navy League believes Congress should fund the construction of two OPCs annually. Facing more complex challenges and growing demand signal, the Coast Guard will need fast response cutters acquired at six per year. What a great ship. I visited one in Key West. The capabilities are multiple times the cutters that they are replacing. And I'm amazed at the bridge. The bridge has a very modern layout, makes the seakeeping very easy and greatly reduces that seakeeping workload and allows the crew to concentrate more on a mission. The National Security Cutter acquisition is a success story. These cutters work well in far-off regions and provide better seakeeping, higher sustained transit speeds, and greater endurance and range. They also provide an increased array of mission versatility, among their other benefits. The Navy League is concerned with the increasing capability gap caused by the rapid decommissioning of operational assets before replacements are available. This cost-driven strategy is not in the best interest of homeland security. The answer is new ships sooner. The old ones cannot be run effectively, and in some cases, can't be run safely. On the aviation front, the Coast Guard will begin using the C-27J aircraft acquired for the inter-service transfer. It'll save about $500 million in acquisition costs. It's a great example of inter-service cooperation. In the near future, the Coast Guard will need to make significant investments in its unmanned aircraft systems. This will be a significant part of the total force package for major cutters. The Coast Guard still faces many of the same challenges that come with every major acquisition program, including increased costs, driven by material cost increases and less than optimum production runs. However, these increased costs have not been met with increased funds, meaning program delays, which in turn increase costs for in-service vessel sustainment. This diverts already limited funds from acquisition, further exacerbating the funding shortfall. Shore infrastructure repairs are estimated to cost $1.4 billion, but the Coast Guard has only been given about $40 million a year for this needed investment. The costs are increasing faster than the Coast Guard can pay, yet another devastating cycle. The need for new polar icebreaker deserves special consideration. Coast Guard must have a sustained presence there. We need to invest more, but we cannot allow this investment to disrupt other planned capitalization. The top line of the acquisition budget must increase. The committee could also consider a special fund outside the normal AC&I budget for an icebreaker similar to the National Sea-Based Strategic Deference Fund created for the National Defense Authorization Act. The alternative is not funding a new polar icebreaker and is a U.S. abdication of Arctic influence and responsibility. All the major decision makers have agreed the Coast Guard's recapitalization and modernization plan, current funding levels, will not sustain the Coast Guard mission. We recognize the fiscal environment, but given the role of the Coast Guard, saving American lives, safeguarding our national security, and contributing to economic prosperity by ensuring the free flow of commerce, we believe the service deserves special consideration. In his annual address, the Commandant stated the Coast Guard has lost nearly 40% of our acquisition budget over the last 4 years. This pattern can no longer continue. The lack of assets and presence where needed causes the Coast Guard to make tough decisions every day about which mission to support. The Navy would like to thank this committee for its leadership, thank Congress for being supportive of the Coast Guard and ensuring they have the resources they need. We must be good shipmates to all of them, as they have been to every American. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much for your testimony. All of you, thank you very much. The point of this hearing is to get to how we get you the most stuff for the least amount of money on time, right? That's the point of this, I guess. And finishing or piggybacking on what Mr. Offit said, if the Coast Guard is making, and the GAO has said that the Coast Guard makes trade-offs within the annual budget process every year. We've heard that from you before. It's not a good strategy long-term, and I would like you to tell us why, number one. And number two, what does the Coast Guard risk by doing it like that every year? Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, you're right. We have said that for actually a number of years now. What they risk by this churn every year when the budget comes through is obviously delaying some assets. We've seen that recently with the fast response cutter, which will lead to more cost down the road. What we would like to see, as we've said for a number of years, is a long-term plan that sets forth what's needed and, importantly, addresses these trade-offs that can be made so that everybody, there's transparency, everybody can see what's coming down the pike, what is needed to pay for it, and what some of the trade-off options might be.
And again, what are the downsides if they don't do it through their SIP and they do it every year and react quickly to whatever the budget request is from the president and our authorization and appropriations? What do they risk?
The risk is that they had, for example, plan to buy 6 fast response cutters a year. The budget comes in less than they had expected. They have to stretch the procurement out. That's just an example. That could happen in any number of different programs. So stretching out schedule means operators aren't getting the assets on the schedule that they had expected them, and it can also lead to increased costs.
That's true. Admiral, one question here. Based on the SIP that you have now and kind of along the same line of thought, what programs of record, what acquisition items will be delivered on time?
We're delivering all of our acquisition programs on time right now.
So everything?
The problem is the what's the baseline. When we have to change the schedule based on funding, then they get pushed to the right. So if you look back at the original baseline, they're delayed. But if you look at what they require based on that funding level, they're delivering on time. We're delivering on time and on budget.
So you're saying when you change the schedule to match the budget, then things are on time in the new schedule. If you use an old schedule, an original one, then things are no longer on time.
Yes, sir. Okay. That's correct. And what happens is when we stretch them out, that lack of predictable funding increases cost for the program. Time costs money, especially on a major program. And as we stretch them out, you still incur the overhead and the fixed costs that go along with that production. Let me just give you an example. We've got the same team building NSCs right now where we've got 4 of them on contract that we did when we only had 1 on contract. So we're able to apply that same overhead, the same oversight to a greater number of cutters, greater number of assets. So the per unit cost is much more efficient when you can build them fast. When we spread them out, it slows it down, and then that increases the per unit cost.
I think what he said is absolutely right. It's that churn every year that in the past has led to having to do new baselines every year, which is not a small thing to undertake to reflect the stretched out schedules. That's just not the most efficient way to operate an acquisition program.
So fill me in then, out of ignorance, because I don't know, how do you compare, if you're trying to compare whether you're on time or not and whether programs are being delivered on time, how do you do that if your schedule, what baseline do you use if you really wanted to get an accurate look at originally when are things supposed to be built and being delivered? What baseline do you use?
We use the currently approved APB, the Acquisition Project Baseline, that is approved by the department. When things get stretched out because of funding problems, that requires a new APB. Otherwise, you would go into breach.
Okay, but how do you tell if stuff is being delivered on time or not based on if you change the baseline every year and you change the schedule to match the programs not being on time, but you change the schedule to match them so that they're on time, how do you know which projects are really not on time? Meaning, what original baseline do you use from 3 or 4 years ago?
Well,
that at all now?
Well, yes, sir, we do. It comes down to what is the cost. If it's a funding delay or a contract delay, is it a program management problem, or is it just we just didn't have the funding to put it on contract? So in the big picture, you'd go back to the original baseline and say, we're behind in recapitalizing the Coast Guard because we haven't built all these ships that we thought we were going to have built by this time, so we're behind. From a project manager's point of view, contract management, what you bought, are you delivering, you know, within the contract that you said you were going to buy it to? You can manage to that and you're on time, but it's really two separate timelines that you're managing to, and it's very difficult to keep them all straight.
Thank you, Mr. Garamondi.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to go to the heart of the question here. It appears as though, Ms. Macklin, if you could help me with this, that the maximum money needed annually is somewhere north of $2 billion for the acquisition programs, for all of it?
That's approximately right, again, based on the current mission needs statement and program of record, which in essence is the Deepwater program. So that's why the Coast Guard is now revisiting that mission needs statement. That's important. We're still dealing to a large extent with a very dated mission needs statement.
In your analysis, and for all three of you, there are two ways to get at this. You adjust the mission needs statement to the available money, or you adjust the mission needs statement to the available needs of the 11 statutory responsibilities. Which are you suggesting be done? Which of those two options?
What we would really like to see, and as this subcommittee is also called for in the Authorization Act, is a long-term plan that sheds some light on what's needed over a 20-year period and indicates what these trade-offs need to be. And that way, decision makers at DHS in Congress can see what those trade-offs are. With the current 5-year SIP or annual budget process, you don't have that long-term visibility that we think would really help the Coast Guard get what it needs to meet its missions.
If I may.
Yes.
I believe that the mission needs statement is a different statement that says, based on all of my statutory requirements and everything, if I were to fulfill all of those needs, here's what I would have to have, and that's the mission needs statement. Then you have perhaps this 20-year plan, which recognizes the budget realities, and it shows, in essence, what I would call a working budget document, which most every business develops, says, here's where I think I am, and then you could compare the two and see what your gap is for your mission needs statement. But I wouldn't want to take that mission needs statement, which takes all of your statutory authorities, you know, from Congress, administration, down through, and your interaction with DOD, and change that. And I agree, that needs updated. So I think what the problem is getting this correct in your CIP, you're calling it? Yes.
Well, Admiral, considering what the two have said, what's your response? What about the mission needs statement? How do we get there? Are we even trying to get a new mission needs statement?
Yes, ranking member, we are doing a new mission needs statement this summer, as was mentioned earlier, and that's going to drive to a new CONOPS, and then we're going to be reevaluating the program of record, both across aviation, cutters, and everything else, because it's a balanced system. The number of cutters influences the number of aircraft, and the C-27Js have certainly thrown a new wrinkle into that program of record, so we do need to visit that, but you have to start with that mission need statement. Whether we start with a constrained mission need statement or an unconstrained mission need statement, I think it needs to start with an unconstrained mission need statement that says what is the mission we're required to do, but then it also has to be adjusted for the budget realities.
Therefore, it would seem to me that for our purposes, we would need to see the unconstrained mission statement and then compare that to the constrained mission statement, the latter being really a result of the inability of the administration and Congress to provide the wherewithal for the unconstrained mission statement. So the two would then put pressure on us to address the differential. Am I correct here? Is that how this could be done? Now, when will you complete this process so that we might actually be forced to make a decision?
We're doing the mission need statement this summer in the CONOPS. Then we're going to be doing the simulations of potential fleet mixes and measuring the effectiveness of all those potential fleet mixes throughout the year. And we're looking at the end of FY16 of having all those potential fleet mixes figured out, where we have the mission effectiveness of those fleet mixes balanced against the cost of those fleet mixes. But it all starts with the mission need statement that's coming out this summer, sir.
So we're really looking to the next Congress before we're going to be able to really drill down and address this fundamental challenge. I think that's, as I look at the timing, about the way it will be. Am I correct? I think so.
It would be the fourth quarter of 16.
Well, it's the next Congress that will deal with it. In any case, Ms. Macklin, is there in... I'll ask all three of you. In looking at this as you know it today, given the uncertainty because of the process not being completed, is there any reason to believe that we're not going to be looking at a number north of $2 billion?
I will just say that the last time the Coast Guard did a fleet mix analysis, which was a few years ago, it was not constrained, and it came in quite high, quite a bit higher than the program of record. At that point, the program of record was considered the floor. It could not be breached. What we would like to see is, you know, the realistic budget projections showing, as you indicated, what can you do in a more constrained environment so that that can be transparent, and then the trade-offs can be made in an informed way.
I think what I'm driving at, or want to drive at here, is that it looks to me as though under any circumstance going forward, however this thing turns out, we could wait until the next Congress, a year and a half, actually a little more than a year and a half from now, and then go back through it, or we can begin to prepare ourselves today for the reality that we're going to have to look at something close to or greater than $2 billion a year in order to meet even the minimum requirements. I can't imagine a situation where it's going to come in less than that, unless you are adjusting the requirements to the constrained budget situation. Now, an additional $1 billion for the Coast Guard activities would seem to be impossible until we consider all of the choices that the Congress makes about where to spend money. For example, Mr. Hunter and I have spent some time on the Armed Services Committee, where vast amounts of money are spent on projects that may or may not be as essential as the Coast Guard's programs. So my concern as a member of Congress is that we look across the program lines, stovepipes, if you will, and say maybe we should move $1 billion a year from some activity in the defense budget or in one of the social welfare budgets over to the Coast Guard, so that the Coast Guard could have the assets that it needs to pluck surfers out of the surf on the beaches of California when they're in trouble, or all of the other missions that you have. So I think this is a challenge for us, and particularly a challenge that our budget committees ought to be looking at. Now, am I willing to wait until the next Congress, which I would hope to participate in? but may not, to get at this? The answer is no. So I want us, in our role, and particularly I think Mr. Hunter and I, who play a role on both committees, to look at this in a more total systems way. We know, for example, that the U.S. Navy cannot operate in the Arctic without an icebreaker. Yet we have no money for the icebreaker in the Coast Guard budget. We know that the U.S. Navy must be prepared to operate in the Arctic. There's no question about that. So how can we move money from one pot to another pot to achieve the purposes of addressing the United States government's responsibilities in the Arctic in total? And the answer is we could do that if we thought about this in a more holistic way. And that's the end of my speech on this matter, but I am intending to pursue that and would need your help. I don't want to wait until 2016, the next Congress. I'd like to have a interim report along the way as you develop your new approach to what is necessary. So at the end of the summer, you expect to have the first stage done. Is that right, Anbo?
Ranking Member, yes, sir.
Are you prepared to deliver to us at that point the elements of the first stage, the results of the first stage?
We're committed to being very open and transparent with Congress, and anything we can do to help
good
would
we,
be
we know where to find each other.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. I'll yield back.
Thank the gentleman. And Admiral, on that same vein, if you could just get us all of your major acquisition program of record projects in all together would be nice. And I would like what you had for a baseline 10 years ago, maybe every 2 years, and I'd like to see where it started before I was even here, and then how it's proceeding and how the baseline has changed to where it was to where it is. And if you could do that, that's everything with a acquisition project baseline, right?
Right. We can certainly do that, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, that'd be great. Mr. Graves.
Thank you for being here this morning. I appreciate your testimony. It was very helpful, all three of you. Admiral, the original mission needs statement with the acquisition schedule back in 05, in retrospect, was that flawed?
That was done during the deep water era. The program of record was pretty good. We all of our studies since then have validated that program of record, and that's why we stayed with it. Some of the scheduling and funding requirements were probably flawed, but the actual program of record itself was actually a good piece of work, and it's been validated many times over the course of the years.
You're a law enforcement agency, and I'm gonna take a guess that you've received a speeding ticket or something at some point in your life. Like you look like maybe no. All right, well, I sure have. but let me ask you. I mean, if you were a cop and you pull somebody over and that person goes back to the speed limit sign and just no, it actually isn't 60 miles an hour, it's 80 miles an hour, and so I'm fine. You can't change the rules in the middle. And you know, you indicated that the mission needs statement in 05 was largely appropriate, but it sounds like as you were answering questions before that you guys have repeatedly revised the schedule in accordance with funding availability. And I'm trying to discern, and I think going back to the previous questions, what kind of problems is that causing if you're continuing to move the Gantt chart to the right, move your schedule to the right? Look, this was obviously put together with the idea that you were going to be able to deliver certain services and perform certain duties. Are you still able to fulfill your mission?
Congressman Graves, as we move schedules to the right, it's very disruptive to the programs and the projects. It's very inefficient. Major acquisitions have a lot of mass momentum. The contracts are structured for a certain schedule. When you deviate from that schedule, it's very difficult to change that, and it causes a lot of disruption and a lot of inefficiency, both on the government side and the contractor side. One of the things we're trying to do now, and we're doing it, you see with the NSCs, is get on annual efficient production rates. We had a big gap on the NSC between the third and fourth and the second and third, and that caused us a lot of reduced learning and cost problems at the yard. Now we're on an annual rate between 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8, and we're seeing the increased efficiency. We're going down the learning curve, and we're seeing the cost benefits of doing that. We're trying to do that with all of our remaining programs. OPC is structured to be as efficient as possible and to be able to stay on that original baseline and not deviate as we go. Because once you deviate as you go and you have a delay, delays tend to cause more delays. They tend to cascade on you, and it all costs additional funds.
Mr. Graves, may I comment?
Sure, please.
Two quick comments. One, you asked if they could perform the mission. All the services will perform their mission to the best of the ability they have with all the assets they have. There's absolutely no question about that. So the answer is yes, they'll do the missions that are in front of them to the best of their ability. The question about deep water, which hasn't been raised, is that the program of record still looks fairly good based on what you knew in 05. Remember, in deep water, there was a management scheme chosen that just didn't work out. For a number of reasons, and so the changing of that management scheme, getting rid of a prime contractor and bringing it back into the internal government and Coast Guard, actually has probably helped a lot. But remember, that was one of the major perturbations in that program, even though it continued to move forward.
And so you would expect, as a result of that change, that you would perhaps go back and revisit schedules. But it seems like that some of the budget requests that we're seeing right now are compounding schedule problems even more than that evolution from Deepwater to the other changes. But let me pivot over to the OPC. As I understand, that's the Coast Guard's number one acquisition priority. Yet there's no funding in the budget request this year for that vessel. Are you ready to go to detailed design this year?
We will be awarding detailed design in 16. We just finished preliminary design. We couldn't be happier with the progress that the contractors are making. All three contractors have moved to the contract design phase, and we're going to be ready to award detailed design this summer and pick the final contractor.
Last question. What are the negative implications of delays on schedules for the OPC in regard, as at previous hearings we had, joint hearing with the HASC, the Coast Guard has a mission that's zippered in with the Navy and other services in many cases, and of course domestic missions with drug interdiction, alien interdiction, and others. Could you address that?
Certainly, sir. The OPC was designed for affordability. The whole acquisition strategy was designed end-to-end for affordability. And that requires us staying on schedule, getting to 2 per year production. We're not looking for innovative designs in terms of technology. We're looking for innovation in terms of production efficiency. So it's designed for production efficiency. That's how we're going to make it affordable and using the competition to get there. But we need to stay on schedule so the contractors get the 2 per year where they can run down that learning curve and accrue all the benefits that accrue by having that steady, stable, predictable funding stream.
Thank the gentleman. The gentlelady from Florida is recognized.
Thank you very much. Thanks, Mr. Chair. So, I'm from South Florida, so obviously the Coast Guard plays a very important role for our economy and our security. I just wanted to follow up on Mr. Graves' question, because we got a memo here that said that there was not money in the budget for the work that needs to be done on the OPC. So where is the money going to come from?
There's a general provision in the budget request to allow the department to reallocate funding to provide the detailed design, the $70 million basically hole that we have in our budget for detailed design, to make that award in 16.
So you have that. Then how long does it take after that? What's the timeline once that's done?
Once we down select to a contractor, there's 18-month detailed design period. And during that design period, they also order their long lead material. And as soon as we're done with the detailed design, we'll be starting construction.
And is there money for that?
There isn't money for that, but we don't need that yet because that will be an option on the contract. So we'll need that in, you know, in future years, in the out years.
So what's your estimate, your best estimate as to actually when those assets will be delivered?
They'll start delivering in 2021, ma'am.
Oh, okay. What happens to the assets that we're using in the meantime? Are they going to last?
That's what our concern is. Some of the assets that are being replaced are 50 years old. The oldest one being the Coast Guard Cutter Reliance is 51 years old. It's currently getting the job done, but as you put Band-Aids on them, at some point there's nothing for the Band-Aid to stick to. Those assets need to be decommissioned and replaced. The other class that the OPC will replace is the 270-foot class, and they're 30 years old now. We just finished the MEP, the Mission Effectiveness Project, on them that bought us a few years, and we're evaluating their condition right now to see what we have to do to those ships to extend them a little bit longer. Our goal is not to spend any more money than we have to on the legacy fleet, but to make sure we can cover our capability gaps until the OPCs replace them.
So what are the potential consequences of this gap not getting the current fleet up to standard, so while we wait for the new fleet?
If we maintain our current schedule, the gap is not that large. It's manageable. The concern is if we don't get started on OPC, the gap could be very large. And then it calls into the question, what is our offshore mission capability in the future?
So could you be more specific as what would be potential consequences?
Drug enforcement, marine environmental protection. These cutters perform the whole host of Coast Guard missions off our coasts and in our EEZ. So depending on what part of the country you're in, it's the fishery stocks up in New England. It's migrant interdiction down in Caribbean, drug interdiction in Caribbean and also in the Eastern Pacific. LMR up in Alaska. That's a big concern for us. Our fishery stocks are very important to us, and we need to be able to manage them in the future.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. I waive the rest of my time.
Thank the gentlelady. I want to go back really quick. You're getting $70 million for the final design review, or the final design. That's going to come from within the department, meaning it hasn't been – it's not authorized. It's not – it's maybe probably not going to be appropriated. The way you're doing it right now is DHS – just says, hey, we had $70 million in our general fund that was unaccounted for, and we'd like you to have it.
Mr. Chairman, that
is that what it is, or
it's
really
general provision?
I was trying to mischaracterize it, but I didn't. That was actual. So that is what is happening.
In short, yes, sir.
So what happens if they don't give you the $70 million? Meaning, what if something else breaks in some other department and they have to spend the money for that?
Well, this is the Coast Guard's number one priority. The Secretary is very interested in Coast Guard recapitalization, and he is certainly making it one of his priorities. And we're working with DHS to make sure that we have the money available when we want to make the award this summer.
Okay, Ms. Mackin, could you help explain to me, because I'm fairly new here, right? How does that work? If the money's not authorized and it's not appropriated, it just comes out of the department. Can you explain that to me? I mean, how do you, when it comes to tracking and when it comes to having foresight on these things and scheduling, how does that work?
To be honest, I don't have any more details than you do on this. We saw what you did, which was the general provision that was referenced that directed DHS to transfer the money to the Coast Guard. I'm not quite sure how that will work in terms of the mechanics. Sorry.
Would it hurt? What happens if the money is appropriated from Congress as opposed to a handshake deal with DHS? Anything, or the money is the money? Doesn't matter.
From the acquisition side, we're in the execution business. We execute the funds that are provided to us wherever they come from.
So it doesn't matter, really?
Not to us, no.
Okay. Mr. Graves, do you have any more questions?
Yeah.
Mr. Graves is recognized. I'm sorry, Mr. Garamundi is recognized.
Mr. Graves has some very good questions. And I want to yield just a few minutes at the end of this to my colleague who has a question that she'll ask. But I got a, there's a whole series of questions that I think we need for the record, and we'll make those available to you. The fast response cutter engine problem, we need to have some information on that. The C-27Js, while you do have seven or eight of them, are they operational? What's going to be necessary to make them operational? What additional work needs to be done on that? This question is about operational testing, the effectiveness of that whole program. We'll get you the specifics on these, and if you could present those to us in writing for the record, it'll save some time here. I do have just one very specific question, partly because of my history dealing with this issue. The Department of Interior recently, this week, issued a permit for Shell Oil to drill off the Arctic coast. Was the Coast Guard involved in that, and how do you propose to provide the necessary or the potential support for that drilling? I know it's not acquisition, but.
No, Ranking Member, I know we are currently involved with the Department of Interior and BSEE and in the partnership, because it's we're all involved in those communications and those deliberations.
And for the record, because it's really not your turf, I'd like to know the specific involvement of the Coast Guard in providing the support. The last time Shell attempted to drill in that area, they had a problem that required a lot of support from the Coast Guard. And I want to know how the Coast Guard intends to work on that. But my next question, so for the record, if you can.
Be happy to provide that, sir.
Thank you. This is a question for the Navy League. You have made a proposal here that there be some sort of a special account for the recapitalization of the icebreaker. Could you expand on that and tell us how that might work?
I'm sorry, I keep forgetting. Since both of you are on the Armed Services Committee, and we actually proposed a long time ago, I think, I don't know if the idea originated with Navy League or it came from somewhere else, that the Ohio Replacement Program also.
Take credit or blame, as the case might be.
Whichever. We'll take the credit.
Okay.
We have been proposing something like that in our maritime policy, which we develop annually for a long time, and it has come to fruition. I just think it's a great way. Part of the problem we have in government is getting our different agencies to work together, and we ought to look and see who this benefits. And quite frankly, there are five or six different agencies that could, in fact, participate in this program of a super fund, if you want to, maybe that's got bad taste in our mouth, but a strategic fund that would contribute to the icebreaker problem. And it's, you know, one's not enough. As we have said before, it's somewhere in the 3 to 6 region. If we're going to cover our responsibilities both in the Antarctic and the Arctic with what we're seeing in ice cap retreat and some of those kinds of things. So, and I would leave it to your councils to figure out how that fund could get set up. That's what lawyers are for, correct?
So that was the National Sea-Based Strategic Deterrent correct. Fund, which are submarines.
Yes.
And that was set aside. So you're suggesting something similar
correct.
To that.
I am.
Well, we need to work on that, and I've already talked about the cross across these two budgets. I'd like to yield the remaining my time to my. Okay, very good. Then I'll just let it go at that. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Graves.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Going back to the OPC, if you can't award the contract in 16 and going back to the somewhat tenuous funding, what is the impact to the Coast Guard folks in the fleet?
Well, Congressman, the biggest impact to the fleet will be that gap that we talked about and having to spend additional funds on ships that probably aren't worthy of those additional funds. Just a quick aside, I was assigned to the Coast Guard Cutter Reliance, which is the oldest 210, the first ship that this OPC will be replacing. When I first graduated in 1984 from the Academy, it was 20 years old at the time, and it was already late for its midlife. The ship was not safe to sail, and I kind of still carry some harbor some resentment to the leadership of the Coast Guard that they asked us to sail on that ship that could not make water, where nothing worked, where it was full of lead paint and asbestos. And when Challenger blew up in 1986, we couldn't get underway, even though we were right there in Port Canaveral for the recovery efforts, because our exhaust stacks were cracked and we'd fill the ship with carbon monoxide every time we lit the engines off. Admittedly, the ship is in much better shape now.
Sounds like college.
We took it, and it had to be, you know, that the Coast Guard took it, and it moved it up in the midlife cycle, and that was part of the recovery process for that ship. And I visited it while I was in MEP at the Coast Guard Yard a couple years ago. It's in much better shape now. But again, there you get to the point where we just can't ask our young folks to get underway anymore on ships like that. We went 2 years without showers at sea because we couldn't make water. Those kind of conditions, I wouldn't put my son, who's in the Coast Guard, on a ship like that, and I wouldn't put other people's children on a ship like that. So we're getting to the point where we need to do something on the OPC, or we're going to have to put people's children on ships like that.
Thank you very much. I appreciate the feedback there. That's very helpful. Pivoting over the FRC, acquisition there is going smoothly from your perspective. I heard Mr. Uffitt talk about how much he enjoyed those boats.
It is. We have the RFP on the street right now for the remaining 26. We have 32 on contract on the first phase.
Yep.
They're very successful operational platforms. They're down working the Caribbean. They were very busy this spring with the changing of the relationship with Cuba. And there was some misinformation on the potential change in wet foot, dry foot policy or immigration policies. And they were very busy, but because they were there and they took care of business, and we didn't have a large migration effort or a large migration incident because of that. It's been a very successful program for us. The ranking member mentioned the engines. We've had some warranty issues with the engine. It's a firm fixed price contract with a rock solid warranty, so the engine manufacturer has been very forthright in fixing those things and taking care of those things. But we have had more issues than we expect on the with that particular engine. But we're working our way through it, and we anticipate more on time and on schedule deliveries for that cutter class,
which would be awarding 26 in April of next year.
It'll be awarded in 16, yes, sir.
Okay. Last question for Ms. Mackin and for you, Admiral, on the Arctic and Antarctic capabilities, icebreaker capabilities. In comparing U.S. capabilities to other countries, do you think we're where we need to be, yes or no?
Well, I mean, obviously, I'm biased. We obviously are not where we need to be.
It's been a somewhat of a tortured process watching for the last 10-plus years this whole decision on Polar Sea, Polar Star. Where do we go from here? You're asking for additional funds to do another condition assessment and chart a path forward. Could you just try and paint your vision on what the appropriate path forward is for us to get where we need to be in regard to icebreaking capabilities? And again, Ms. Mackin, I'd love to hear your thoughts on that as well.
First, we're going to have to build a new polar icebreaker. Polar Star would be a potential bridging gap. I'm sorry, Polar Sea would be a potential bridging gap. But at the end of the day, we're still going to have a ship, if we reactivate her, that has fuel against the hull, that doesn't meet Clean Air Act requirements, that doesn't have the environmental capabilities that current ships need to have, especially working in a pristine environment like we see in Antarctica and up in the Arctic. So it only delays the inevitable, but we still need to build a new icebreaker. The problem with a new icebreaker is it has such a long lead time. It's a very significant asset. The design is very unique. The construction is very unique. It's going to take a long time to build. So we need to get started with that, whether or not we reactivate Polar Sea or not. Reactivating Polar Sea is a very interesting question because the hull is pretty good. But if we try to take everything out of the hull and rebuild it from the top, it's a very expensive shipbuilding evolution. Modern ships are built in blocks, not in stick built from the ground up. So whether we would actually be cost-effective or feasible in reactivating Polar Sea in that way remains to be seen, and we've got some significant engineering work that we have to do to make a smart decision on that.
Thank the gentleman. Ms. Frankel.
Thank you. Well, it does sound like there was a planning error, probably on the part of, it's probably Congress, but I don't know, because with this gap, I just want to say, how much is it going to cost, do you think, to do these repairs during the gap period?
Now, Ms. Frankel, it would depend on how big the gap is, what our new program of record comes out to be in terms of how many cutters we need and what that new mission needs statement says. Our goal would be not to spend any more on old ships than we have to. And we probably wouldn't have to do all of them. It would be take the best couple and do what we have to do to them to carry ourselves across. But at this point, until we come out with a new program of record and we finish our engineering work on assessing what the 270s would take, we really can't provide a number.
Well, I mean, do you think it's going to be in the millions?
Oh, yes, ma'am, definitely in the millions. I mean, it's it very significant. If it wasn't,
yes,
we would just be doing it.
Yeah, okay. All right, I'm going to go to another subject. It sounds like this is a touchy subject for you. But I'm sure we didn't help me much with this. I have a problem with bridges. I don't know whether you have anything to do with bridges, but South Florida, maybe you've heard of this issue. We have, it's down in Broward County in Fort Lauderdale, there is a train bridge. There's a bridge that in order for the trains to go back and forth, the bridge goes down and then there's no boats. I mean, I've been there, not even a canoe. I mean, you'd have to sort of like lie flat in a canoe to even get under it. And we literally have hundreds of businesses that cater to boats and yachts and so forth. But there's no way to get from the intercoastal, from the east part of the bridge to the west part of the bridge, under that bridge, when it's down. And there are going to be lots more trains going back and forth, and this is a very slow bridge getting up and down. So I'm just, do you get involved with these kinds of bridges?
Ma'am, I use bridges, but I'm not part of the regulatory process of bridges, and we'd be more than happy to take a question for the record and address that specific bridge.
Is there a budget for bridges? Does the Coast Guard have?
Well, we regulate the bridges, and we permit them. And we are certainly involved in them. I don't suspect that we pay for all the bridges out of the Coast Guard budget.
If
I recall correctly, within the law, there is such a program, unfunded for many, many years now.
But Truman Hobbs program. And yeah, this administration has not funded it, but it deals with impediments to navigation.
Yeah. So go find some money.
Okay. Impediment to navigation, okay.
I think you can get flatter canoes.
We will submit a question.
Yes, ma'am. We'd be happy to answer that.
Thank the gentlelady. Mr. Curbelo.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank all of you for your time this morning. The FY16 budget requests $340 million to acquire six fast response cutters. These are very important to our area, certainly in South Florida. And this would be the first order under the recompeted contract that the service expects to award by April 2016. Do you still expect to award the recompeted contract for the remaining 26 FRCs by April?
Yes, sir, we do. The RFP is on the street now. We're answering questions from potential vendors, and we see no reason why we would have any problems meeting that date.
That's wonderful. I commend you on that, and I will hold you to it, because in my visits down to Key West and Miami, we all know how critical these vessels are. So I appreciate it. That's all I got, Mr. Chairman. Thank you. I yield back.
Thank the gentleman. Hey, on the OPC, let me see. Before you award next year, OMB wants you to do an alternatives analysis. Is that right? Of different types of ship designs?
Of different sea state type sizes. One would be a modernized MEC if we took the existing capabilities of the existing MEC fleet of a 270 and modernized it to current conditions. What would that cost?
But do you, meaning, how much is it going to cost you to do the design alternatives? Do you have to take a lot of money to do that, to do ship design, or you don't have to go as far on it so it's not as expensive, or what?
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, it's not a complete design. It was just a kind of a concept using parametric figures for costs, and what would that ship look like if we tried to build it today to modern standards, and then what would be a parametric rough order magnitude cost of that? It's not a complete design study.
But your RFP that is out there now, right?
Yes.
The RFP that's out there now has a specific design template, or no, not at all, or?
It, what we have out there is we have performance requirements. It's required to meet the naval vessel rules. It's also got a Coast Guard addendum, which applies many commercial specs to the NVR. So it's not a Navy ship, and it's not a commercial ship. It's a Coast Guard cutter. It's designed to be a specific Coast Guard cutter. It's not plans and specs on how to build a ship. It's not like what's out on the FRC right now, because each contractor is designing their ship, their product, to be built efficiently in their yard. So they've got to meet all our requirements and all the NVR specifications and everything that we required. It's a pretty thick, lengthy specification because we've been operating ships like this a long time. We know what we need. But they have to meet those performance requirements, and then that's what they're submitting that'll be evaluated and awarded.
Okay, could you get this committee the alternatives that you're looking at? Just the 210 MEC change and whatever other alternatives you guys have in mind? And you're not doing that. I'm just having a hard time understanding. Are you doing that for fun?
No, we're doing it just
because you're not really going to use it. You're just doing it.
It's a cost excursion. It's somewhat of an academic exercise, okay, just to make sure that our program record is the most optimum program that we're doing, and we get the greatest bang for the buck from a cost benefit perspective that meets the mission need at what cost. It's all part of our affordability program for the OPC.
Okay. Last month, Admiral Michel said that the recompete for the FRCs that's going on right now, he said that they made some changes. The subcommittee was unaware that you were going to put in different design requirements for the second batch of FRCs. And he said, no, that's the way it was supposed to be all along. So I would like to ask Ms. Mackin, when it comes to changing specs, can they, because Admiral Michel was very straightforward and said this will not raise cost or it'll not make it go over schedule either. He goes, well, it's just a few changes and it'll be fine. On the Armed Services Committee and other acquisition stuff, there's no such thing as a few changes and it'll all be fine. So I would just like your point of view on that, on them changing specs, minimum. They're doing small changes, nothing crazy. But still, how do you think that's going to affect the schedule and the budget for the FRC, the second tranche of buys?
Well, it's correct. This was always the plan to recompete the second part of the FRC buy, and we definitely think competition, and especially in a firm fixed price environment like the FRC, will drive prices down. It's infinitely better than a sole source environment. So from that perspective, we certainly do support the Coast Guard strategy. That said, I think you're right. They will have to be careful about managing the requirements, scrutinizing what the contractors may come back with to make sure that costs do stay under control.
Sir, if I could, because we're competing it and because you had a incumbent shipbuilder, if we just said, here's the plans and specs, build the exact same ship, that would have a negative effect on competition, because who could come in and compete with a shipyard that's already building the exact same ship? So when we went out to industry and we asked them in our industry engagement, we realized that we were going to have a lack of competition if we did, say, build the exact same ship. We'd like to get the same ship. We like the ship, and from a life cycle perspective, that's the way to do it. On the other hand, in order to get the competition to drive down acquisition costs, as Ms. Mackin mentions, is the way to do that, we wanted to open up as much as the ship as we can. The performance requirements are all the same. It has to meet all the same performance requirements. We took the things that were really important to us to have standardized because we've got a large infrastructure associated with it in terms of training and things like that, spare parts. So we specified things like electrical switchboards, engines, things that they couldn't change. And then the other things we said, okay, outside of these things, you can change if you like. And that was done to hopefully increase competition and let alternative vendors come in and then
okay, let me ask it this way. I'm all for competition, but maybe Ms. Mackin, you can answer this, or maybe Mr. Offit too. If you have a batch where you make 20 ships, let's just say you got a company that makes 20 ships, you then change a few specs on it, and then you now say we're going to recompete this as a brand new thing. We're going to put it out there on the market and see who can bite at this. I don't know how anybody could still match the company that made the first 20 ships. No matter what you do, by changing requirements to try to get the competition out there, I don't understand how that works, right? Because they don't have you already have a pipeline, they already have their employees, they already have everything for those 20 ships, and to have a new company come in and say, hey, we can do it cheaper, how? Because usually that's not the case in real life, right?
I think the supply chain is a factor, but you know the incumbent contractor might also sharpen his pencil now that there's competition out there. And with the trade space that other potential vendors have, they might be able to get a better price. It's possible. Just by the basis of their own supply chain, their relationship with their vendors and suppliers. So as I said, though, the Coast Guard will have to manage the requirements and make sure that the costs don't increase as a result of this.
Okay, how likely do you think that is, that costs will not increase as a result of this? You're dealing with a brand new, so let's say somebody brand new gets this contract, right? You're dealing with a brand new contractor that you might not be familiar with, different designs, specs in certain ways, but nothing crazy, right? You said the majority is staying the same. How do costs not go up? I'm just not understanding. Knowing how government works and acquisition stuff, at least on the armed services side, there's no way that costs don't go up.
The major thing is it's a firm fixed price contract. The contractors are bidding at a firm fixed price that they're going to build that ship to meet those performance requirements at a fixed price. There's no share line. It's firm fixed price. So that's really our not guarantee, but that's our warranty against the prices going up. It's not a cost plus contract. You would certainly not want to do this with a different type of contracting vehicle.
All right, anybody else?
You've raised some very important questions, Mr. Chairman, and the answers are almost complete. The word life cycle cost was used in this discussion a moment ago, and it's possible that the next tranche of ships, 20-plus, could be different in significant ways. And that could affect the life cycle costs. You now have two different maintenance systems that you're going to have and two different operational systems. The question, therefore, is are you considering the life cycle cost in the equation on the cheapest, best deal?
Ranking Member, not in terms of our selection criteria, but in terms of how we picked what items have to be the same and what items could be changed, those have the life cycle cost
so in the
attributes.
At the outset, you've taken into account the change that could occur in the life cycle cost, and you've tried to eliminate those factors or those issues, equipment, whatever, that would have an effect on the life cycle cost. Is that correct?
That's absolutely correct, Ranking Member.
Ms. Macklin, do you agree?
Our understanding of the situation is as the Admiral described it.
And you'll be watching closely as
we
this
will
comes.
Be very interested to see how this turns out.
I said earlier that this is an ongoing process. We were talking about the OPC at the time. But it's an ongoing process, and as one member of the committee, and I suspect not the only member, as the process goes forward, I would like to know at the critical stages, how is it going? And not wait until it is a done deal and then call you up here annually and find out why it didn't work out as we thought.
I would be happy to track that.
Thank you. I yield back.
The gentlelady from Florida is recognized.
Just follow up on that question. Are you required by law to take the cheapest bid, or do you look to see what is the best quality?
These are, we use best value contracts.
Best value, okay.
Yes, ma'am.
All right, that's it. Thank you.
I think that's it. I would just like to keep us informed when Secretary Johnson gives you a check for $70 million or so. Let us know when that happens, please. And we're going to try to keep working that here. So just in case something else comes up and they don't do that, there's still maybe a possibility for a different funding stream so that the whole schedule is not put off. But thank you all for being here. Appreciate your testimony. And I think we learned a lot today. And we'll stay on it. The hearing is adjourned.